Well, friends, welcome to our first Together with One Accord Lunch and Learn. It's great to have each one of you joining us today. We are in for such a treat today as we spend a bit of time rediscovering the story of the Great Awakening. But before we start out, we just want to say it's just a blessing to have each one of you. If you have an opportunity, we'd invite you to share this on your Facebook or on your social media. We'd love to be able to extend this resource to as many people as possible. Also, just to let you know that this will be available following the live broadcast as well, if there are others who have missed out on this. And SA Connects will be posting this on SA Connects as well. Before we get started, we just want to remind you that the on May the 22nd, actually the territory is going to be hosting the virtual concert of prayer from 7 to 8 p.m. It's going to be available in English and in Spanish as well. And so we just want to encourage you to invite as many individuals as possible as we come together and actively pursue God's next great awakening. This concept of the concert of prayer actually goes back to something that was introduced by Jonathan Edwards, who we're going to learn about in just a little bit of time. But before we do, let's just revisit what our vision statement is, which Commissioners Bamford have laid out as the vision for this territory. Together with One Accord is based on Acts 2, verse 1, and it talks about us envisioning an army, our territory, and this Salvation Army, united in purpose and actively pursuing God's next great awakening. When we use that term great awakening, it might be something that's a new concept to us, but it talks about a revival that leads to dramatic social reform. It's a future that that we want to see happening, that the Salvation Army is at the forefront of such a reality in our world. Our world desperately needs that. So before we get into things, let's just have a word of prayer and ask the Spirit of God just to speak powerfully through this time. Heavenly Father, we just bow before you at this time. And Lord, we thank you for this movement that you created this movement. Father, you rose this army up for such a time as this. We thank you, Father, that we stand on the shoulders of giants, that that this was not created just in a vacuum, but Father, it's been part of a redemptive thread that you have been weaving together throughout history. And Father, even today, we are a continuation of that. So Spirit of God, as we gather here today to learn, I pray that you would speak into the hearts and into the minds of each person who's listening. Equip us, Father, with the power of the truth of how you have moved throughout history, and help us to believe that it is possible once again for us to realize a great revival that leads to dramatic social reform, a great awakening. Lord, bless our speaker today as he shares with us. And Father, may this be a great moment of insight for us, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, friends, we're going to start out with a bit of fun. We actually have one of Dr. Green's books, The Life and Ministry of William Booth, and we are going to give it away to somebody who is able to answer this question. So go on and type in the answer if you know. What year did William Booth publish his article, Salvation for Both Worlds? If you don't know, you can Google it, but the first person who's able to post in the comments the right answer, the right year, we are going to send this book to you. And so why don't you take a look, and if you've got that, type it in. And I'm just looking at the chat here. It's great to have Commissioner Bamford with us here today as well, and so many guests, but anyone out there able to guess? I'll give you some clues. It was in the 19th century. It was in the 1800s. Anyone want to try? You can even guess. Ah, there we go. Jacob Wynn just landed on the right number. Jacob Wynn said in 1889, and you are the winner. Let's give him a big hand. SA Connects was trying to get 1889 there as well. All right, Jacob Wynn, we'll send this to you. We'll follow up after the show and get your details to send that off to you. But friends, without further ado, I want to introduce to you Dr. Roger Green. Now, he is a member of the Order of the Founder, which means that he's been recognized as an individual who embodies the essence of salvationism, and he reflects the spirit of our founders, William and Catherine Booth. Dr. Green is the editor of the Word and Deed. Along with that, he is the professor emeritus of Gordon College's the professor emeritus of biblical and theological studies. Along with that, on the screen, you'll see that there is a website called Biblical E-Learning. And on that site, there are a couple of great courses which you could take. Some of what Dr. Green's going to be talking about very quickly today. If you want to get deeper into this, I'd encourage you to go to Biblical E-Learning, and you can watch two of the courses which Dr. Green's taught at Gordon College. And then along with that, Dr. Green is a prolific writer. He's written biographies on Catherine William Booth. Along with Dr. Andrew Easton, he's written two reflections on the shorter writings of Catherine William Booth called Settled Views and Boundless Salvation. But his earliest writing was the book War on Two Fronts that looks at that concept of William Booth's salvation for both worlds. And it's actually recently been republished from National Headquarters. And you can pick that up in trade as well. But when we talk about A Great Awakening, revisiting his book on War of Two Fronts would be a wonderful way to really understand how A Great Awakening was part of the founding vision of Catherine and William Booth. Without any further ado, I want to introduce you to Dr. Roger Green. He's coming on screen right now. It's great to have you today. And one fact about Dr. Green is many people might not realize it, but he's actually one of the best tour guides out there. Not only does he do tours in Israel, he's done tours in the United Kingdom to places like the places where William Booth founded the Salvation Army. He also does these in Boston. And last year, literally the day before the world shut down, we were with Dr. Green, and we had an opportunity to walk around Boston, and we found the place you can see there on the screen where D.L. Moody first got converted, and then also the bedrock there shows where Captain Amos Shirley opened the Salvation Army up in Boston. So Dr. Green is a real friend. He's an inspiration and a great mentor and just such a blessing to the Salvation Army. So Dr. Green, thank you so much for joining with us today.
Thank you, Stephen. It is a joy to be with you. And just say a couple of things by word of my own welcome. First, I want to thank Stephen and Sharon for all their hard work on this. This is their project and your project, and they have done a remarkable job. So thank you for that and for the invitation. And thank you for all of those who are joining us or who may be watching this at a later time. It's wonderful to have you and to be with you for this period of time. I just might mention quickly the method that we'll be using today. Stephen will be asking me some questions. We'll be moving into various historical periods that are important leading up to the Salvation Army. We'll be talking about that. But there will be time for some comments, maybe time for some questions. And so we want to encourage you to enter into this kind of conversation with us on this material. I might just add one other thing. If I had one goal of our time together, and I say this a lot in soldiers' conferences and officers' councils and things like that, but as Stephen has already mentioned and actually prayed, we want you and all of us to see that we are part of the great story. We are part of the grand narrative of God, beginning with Abraham and the covenant with Abraham, moving through the Old Testament, coming with the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ and the New Testament, the early church, and so forth. So we need to understand that God has placed us in this grand story. And today we're going to understand a part of that grand story. We're going to look at essential parts of that grand story. So we should always remember that we are not alone. We are part of God's great story.
So, Dr. Green, as we begin to rediscover the story of the Great Awakening, we want to start out by first stepping back and saying, what does this mean? What exactly is a Great Awakening?
For me, the understanding of the Great Awakening is pretty simple. It's being faithful to the command of Jesus to love God and love our neighbor. If we are faithful to that command of Jesus, both individually and as a movement, we are part of God's Great Awakening here on earth.
And that speaks to that salvation for both worlds, that connection with our eternal Father, but along with that temporally with those who are our neighbors, both our friends and even our enemies as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yes, for the whole world.
Yeah. Now, as we begin this sort of weaving this narrative through our roadmap, what is the roadmap which we're going to go on as we rediscover the story of the Great Awakening?
Yeah, this is the roadmap. Now, everyone may not be familiar with all of these, but the Reformation and the Wesleyan Revival, the First Great Awakening, very important, Second Great Awakening, then what we call the Finneyite Revival, spend a few minutes just talking about the Finneyite revival and then the Salvationist revival. And where do we fit into that story of the Great Awakening?
Yeah, that's wonderful. You know, what's exciting is William Booth said in 1879, ours is the state of salvation preached by Luther and Whitfield and Wesley. So we're in that line of tradition. So let's start with Luther and let's go back to the Reformation. Why is the Reformation important for us understanding this story of the Great Awakening?
The Reformation is so important because even Roman Catholic scholars acknowledge that the church in the Middle Ages was really not the church planned by God in the New Testament, and there were problems. And of course, Martin Luther himself was Roman Catholic and was a Roman Catholic monk, an Augustinian monk, and discovering the weaknesses and the frailties and the faults and the problems of the Roman Catholic Church, Martin Luther, by God's choice, Martin Luther was the leader in the Reformation. And if there's anything that really distinguishes the Reformation apart from the Roman Catholic Church of that day, now the Roman Catholic Church has changed greatly, we acknowledge that, but of that day, it was preaching and proclamation of the gospel. And that's one of the things that Martin Luther really acknowledged. I love this definition from Martin Luther. The gospel is essentially proclamation, Christ coming to us through the sermons. So every time there is proclamation, faithful proclamation of the gospel, Christ is coming to the community through those sermons. And that is very important, that quotation from Martin Luther. So he started the Reformation, and the accent in the Reformation was on preaching or proclamation.
And I would imagine as the printing press was able to accelerate the printing of the gospel in the language of people, that people were able to search the scriptures for themselves and test the preaching that was being given to them to validate that, which helped to accelerate the democratization of each individual playing a part in personally proclaiming that.
Absolutely. And personally acknowledging Christ as Savior through the preaching of the gospel.
Yeah.
It wasn't just a community. It was also a personal event. Yeah.
So how did the foundations of the Reformation pave the way towards the Wesleyan revivals?
Yeah, when we come to the Wesleyan revival with John and Charles Wesley, of course, they were Oxford trained, and so they knew well the teachings of the Reformation. And in a sense, they built upon the teachings of the Reformation. And if there are kind of characteristics of the Wesleyan revival, I would mention a few of them. And here's John Wesley before us. But the first one would be preaching the fullness of the gospel. That is, so the emphasis in the Wesleyan revival on preaching, but also preaching the fullness of the gospel, which includes the message of holiness, which was so important to the Wesleys, the Wesleyan revival, and so important to us as people who identify themselves as Wesleyans. The second was, of course, the class meeting, the coming together of small groups. Wesley said this was critical to the strengthening of the church, the coming together of small groups during the week led by a leader. And it wasn't just a Bible study. It was that. But it was also a growing in God's grace through the partnership of those who belonged to the class meeting and a moving toward the image of Christ for each individual in that class meeting. That was important. Some other things that were critical, of course, were, you know, and we'll come upon a picture of Charles Wesley as well. But singing, these people sang their theology. Their theology was important. People learned their theology as much by singing as they did by hearing the word preached. And of course, caring for the poor was also important. So there was not, the Wesleys did not want to have a group of people who were just off by themselves. They wanted to have a group of people who loved God, yes, but also loved their neighbor. So caring for the poor was critical to the Wesleyan revival. I love this quotation of John Wesley. Give me 100 preachers who fear nothing but sin and desire nothing but God, and I care not whether they be clergymen or laymen, they alone will shake the gates of hell and set up the kingdom of heaven upon earth. Amen. So you can see this great kind of importance of proclamation or preaching the gospel as what characterized the Wesleyan revival and what helped to bring about the Wesleyan revival, which lasted 53 years.
So Dr. Green, what you're saying is, okay, so Luther lays this foundation of we need to look at scripture and we need to proclaim that gospel. Wesley comes along and he forms holy clubs, class meetings, which are able to study what that Bible is. That leads to that Altar's Gate experience where his heart's strangely warmed. He experiences holiness, which motivates him to go out and to proclaim, not just in the class meeting, but to the masses,
yes,
Christ is. And not just to only speak it, but through their mouths, but to actually demonstrate it through their hands as they actively engage in service.
Yes, absolutely. That was, in a sense, the open secret of the Wesleyan revival.
I love that term.
We consider ourselves to be the inheritors of Wesleyan Christianity.
Yeah. That's where scripture comes to life. That's different to just simply reading as a cerebral academic exercise. This is allowing truth to penetrate our minds, speaking to our hearts, and translating to our hands and impacting the world.
Right. Absolutely.
I can see how that leads to a great awakening. So as we look at the Reformation to the Wesleyan revival, then we come to the First Great Awakening. Now, this is happening sort of parallel, isn't it?
Yes. The Wesleyan revival and the First Great Awakening in America were parallel movements, and they knew of each other's work. But when we talk about the First Great Awakening, we're really talking about an American phenomenon. So we should look at some of the leaders of the First Great Awakening. And I mentioned Stephen earlier, but I love this slide because it shows how so much of the First Great Awakening was here in what we now call the USA Eastern Territory of the Salvation Army. So the Great Awakening was New England, New York, New Jersey, and so forth. But we have some leaders of the First Great Awakening, and we want to mention them because they are very important if you understand the First Great Awakening. But the first definitely would be Jonathan Edwards. In fact, we generally date the First Great Awakening, 1734, as the beginning preaching of Jonathan Edwards in Northampton. And these are the dates of Jonathan Edwards. But notice that Jonathan Edwards, and notice his dates, but notice that Jonathan Edwards placed the great emphasis on preaching. The Great Awakening came as a result of preaching. The second person we want to mention, too, after Jonathan, here's a quotation from Jonathan Edwards. Holy affections are not heat without light, but evermore arise from some information of the understanding or some spiritual instruction that the mind receives, some light or actual knowledge. And so for Jonathan Edwards, he wanted people to be moved in their heart, their emotions, but he also wanted them to have a greater understanding of what the gospel was for their lives. And that is in keeping with the Matthew 22:37 passage, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Absolutely. If we are not loving God with all of our minds, we're not loving God as Jesus commanded us to. So Jonathan Edwards is a perfect example of that. The second person that we mention is George Whitefield. George Whitefield was called the Great Itinerant because George Whitefield was an English Anglican friend of John Wesley's, even though they did have some theological disagreements, but he was a friend of John Wesley's. And George Whitefield came to America 7 times and preached all the way from Maine down to Georgia. So he is called the Grand Itinerant for his preaching. He not only preached indoors, but of course preached outdoors and convinced John Wesley to begin preaching outdoors as well in the open air meetings. George Whitefield, again, preaching for him was the essence of what an awakening is all about. George Whitefield came to America 7 times, but only took 6 trips home because he died about 10 miles from where we live and is buried in the basement of the church underneath the pulpit there. George Whitefield really belongs to us as well as he belongs to England and belongs to the American, the First Great Awakening. The next person is a person many people would not know, Theodore J. Frelinghuysen, but while the other preachers were bringing their gospel to their kind of denominations, to their people, Theodore J. Frelinghuysen was bringing that same gospel to the Dutch Reformed community, especially in New Jersey, which was growing and quite large. But again, for Frelinghuysen, the emphasis was on preaching and proclamation. And then the next person, the fourth person who's so important here, is Gilbert Tennent. And those are the dates for Gilbert Tennent. I'm just going to tell a quick story about Gilbert Tennent. His father, William Tennent, they lived in New Jersey. And his father felt that his sons would not get a proper theological and biblical training. So he decided that he was going to train his own sons in the ministry. And he erected a log college, a log cabin behind their house. And it was in that log cabin where he trained his sons for the Christian ministry. And Gilbert Tennent was the best known of the sons and brought revivalism to the church, and especially to Presbyterian believers and so forth, a great revivalism. Now, that long story short here, this was derided by all the people who lived around and knew about this log cabin, and they called it the Log College as a derisive name for these people who were learning to preach the gospel. Well, who has the last laugh? Because the Log College was the foundation of Princeton University. So here is Gilbert Tennent. Now, with these four people, if I could just make 2 points quickly. The first is that to use a definition of preaching that we received in seminary, preaching is God's truth coming through personality. Each of these persons had a different personality. Some, like Edwards, were very, what we might say, kind of almost dry preachers, standing behind the pulpit, hardly an illustration, keeping, they said, his vision on the rope of the church bell at the back of the church. And of course, Whitfield was exactly the opposite, very exuberant, lots of illustrations and so forth. But preaching is God's truth coming through personality, there's no doubt. But the second thing I'd just like to mention about these folks, Edwards was Congregational, Whitfield was Anglican, Frelinghuysen was Dutch Reformed, Tennent was Presbyterian. That is, the first Great Awakening was going across denominational lines. It was explosive across the denominations, and that is what is really important. We want to remember that.
Oh, that's great. And I think we can see as well that just like God spoke through their personalities, he can speak through our personalities today as well. Each one of us have a responsibility of embodying that gospel and that truth, and then allowing it to translate through the beauty of who God has created us uniquely to be.
Right. And do it through your own personality. Don't try to imitate someone else in your preaching or in your witnessing or in the way. Don't try to imitate someone else. God is using you specially as an individual. So allow God's truth to come you through your personality. Absolutely.
Right. One of the folks shared the SA Connects article on the Red River Revival meeting. That leads perfectly to the next slide, which is we're going to take a look at how the First Great Awakening paved the way to what was called the Second Great Awakening. And there's two parts to this story, right, Dr. Green?
There are definitely two parts to the Second Great Awakening. The Second Great Awakening in America began right about 1800 or so, but it had two aspects to it. The picture on the left is of Yale at the time, and the picture on the right is to a southern camp meeting. So let's go first of all to the Great Awakening in the North. The leader of the Great Awakening in the North was a man by the name of Timothy Dwight. Now, Timothy Dwight became the president of Yale University. And this is a very interesting picture of Yale at the time. And Timothy Dwight as the president, by the way, Yale University was it was almost kind of an ungodly place at the time. And when Timothy Dwight came to be president, he saw that and said, no, this is not why God raised up Yale University. And so as the president, he took opportunity to preach the gospel in the chapels and teach theology and so forth. And what happened to this, by the way, grandson of Jonathan Edwards, Timothy Dwight, what happened under his ministry is the great revival broke out in the North under the auspices of Timothy Dwight and Yale University. Again, remember that there's no distinction in a sense between loving God with your heart and loving God with your mind, because this, in a sense, part of Dwight's appeal was to, in his sermons, was to love God with your mind, that is, love God fully and wholly. Now, the southern manifestation of the Great Awakening, and here's a good example of camp meetings, the southern manifestation of the Great Awakening was different. It was definitely, it emphasized preaching, like the first Great Awakening, but it was definitely more emotional in its response, as people responded to the preaching of the first Great of the Second Great Awakening. Now, Francis Asbury lived at this time and under and knew and visited many of these camp meetings and was carrying out the gospel in this magnificent way at the time. So Francis Asbury is really a part of this almost southern manifestation of the Second Great Awakening, but himself also a great preacher of the gospel as well. So there were these two manifestations, but the important thing is that there was this, what became known as the Second Great Awakening through New England and New York and New Jersey on the one hand, but also down south in places like Georgia and Kentucky and other places, Tennessee. So the Second Great Awakening was very large in terms of geographical expansion.
Yeah. So it sounds as though the Second Great Awakening in the North was very cerebral. The Second Great Awakening in the South was very emotive.
Yes.
But both places, when you talk about Yale, there were the precondition to the revival is that it was in a state, it was in a mess morally and biblically and things like this. And it's very interesting because in the South, in Red River, Logan County, Kentucky, where the Second Great Awakening started down in the southern place, it was considered rogue county. It was the most primitive place. But in both places, when awakening took place, the revival led to the transformation of that society.
Yes.
You know, and so both had that outcome. And by the way, Old Orchard Beach camp meetings is birthed out of this idea. Asbury saw this and he said, we need to replicate this all throughout the wherever Methodism is, which is where we get the founding of that. But now we come to a point, so we've looked at the Reformation, we've looked at the Wesleyan Revival, the First and the Second Great Awakenings, but now we have this disconnect between the head and the heart. How does Finney fuse those back together again in the Finneyite Revival?
And the Finneyite Revival becomes very important for the Army, because the Army was born, in a sense, out of the Finneyite Revival, because Catherine Booth especially was reading Charles Finney's works, especially his works on revivalism. So Finney brought, now let me just say something, kind of a technical point about the Finneyite Revival. Some scholars feel that the Finneyite Revival is a continuation of the Second Great Awakening, that what we have is a Second Great Awakening that's moving on with Finney and so forth. Other scholars feel there was a bit of a break, and so they're more likely to call this the Third Great Awakening or the Finneyite Revival. That's not for us to adjudicate here, but there was a great revival under Charles Grandison Finney, no doubt about that, which was very important to the Salvation Army. Now, we've got two words up here on the screen, revivalism, but on the other hand, social reform. So revivalism with Finney would be preaching of the gospel. Now, Finney was a great preacher. By the way, if you went to hear him, you had to settle in because he generally preached for about 2 hours. So he took preaching very seriously, obviously, and had a great response always to that preaching. However, Finney was one of the founders. He was the first professor of theology, became the president of Oberlin College. And this other picture is a picture of Oberlin College. Oberlin College was founded specifically as an anti-slavery institution in Ohio. It was founded specifically as an institution which gave women and men, it's the first coeducational college in America, it gave women as well as men the opportunity for education and so forth. So there were these great reform movements going on at Oberlin College under people like Finney, Asa Mahan, and others, but they didn't see, there was no disconnect between those two things. In other words, you don't have to choose between revivalism and social reform. Those two things are two sides of the same coin. And Finney became a great example of that in his writings and was an example of that to the Booths as well.
This is the war on two fronts, right?
This is the war on two fronts, absolutely. And Finney is battling it. And here we have Charles Finney's American ministry. And you mentioned earlier, Stephen, about the Erie Canal. I think you should just mention that here.
Yeah, it's interesting to notice that if you look at where in the center part of New York State, that sort of continuation actually trails exactly where the Erie Canal was. So here you had the frontier in Kentucky, Tennessee, Ohio, and places like that coming into upstate New York. And it's the creation of the Erie Canal that actually bridges that to the New England space and actually leads to the transatlantic revival movement where these ideas now come over to England.
Right. Exactly. Because Finney preached in England. And English preachers like Whitfield from the First Great Awakening preached here in America. So that is the beginning of what we call transatlantic revivalism.
Yeah. I just want to share a note, a comment from online. Isaiah Allen says this: we think of our own society as beyond revival, too far gone. Yet historically, that's just when revival comes.
Yes. Well, a good example of that. Well, we'll probably get to this later as well. But a good example of that is the early church. The early church met with 120 believers in Pentecost, and the world in which they lived was a pagan world, no doubt about that. But look at how God broke into that world, and it was amazing. And look at how strong the church is by the fourth century because of the faithfulness of the believers in those first 400 years, in spite of great persecution and secularization and so forth. Yeah.
So what we've seen thus far is that we have to reconcile the head, the heart, and the hand. You can't have one at the expense of the other. Along with that, you can't have revivalism without reform. These two things go together. While yes, there might be liberalism and fundamentalism that try to separate those, an awakening is one where those two things coexist.
Absolutely. Yes.
So that leads...
That is a repetition of what we started out with of the gospel is loving the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and loving your neighbor as yourself. The preaching and the loving of your neighbor, caring for your neighbor, they go together. You cannot separate those two things.
And so in many ways, we see codified now in this journey, in the salvationist, revivalist, awakening movement, we see a synthesis of these ideas, do we not?
Yes, absolutely. As you've already mentioned, Stephen, but the William and Catherine were aware that they were standing on the shoulders of people like Luther, and of course, certainly the Wesleys, and of course, people like Charles Grandison Finney, especially the books on revivalism of religion, they read greatly. So the Salvationist Revival. Now, there's a couple of things I would mention about that revival. And we do have slides of both William and Catherine, just to remind us of who they were and of some of their writings. Notice in those slides, both slides of, here's William, we see him preaching. Because that's what William thought of himself primarily. He thought of himself as a preacher of the gospel, preacher of the good news. And this slide on Catherine, we see Catherine preaching as well and her proclamation. Now, she actually wrote more about preaching, actual preaching, than William did. And she has many interesting remarks about the importance of preaching. But with both William and Catherine, preaching, proclamation of the gospel was first. Revival comes through preaching. It's interesting that they also represent the point that we made about the First Great Awakening. Preaching is God's truth coming through personality. And it's interesting that they were two different kinds of preachers. Catherine got up behind the podium and she never moved, and it was very intellectual, really almost philosophical at times, and calling people to repentance and calling people to holiness and so forth. William wandered across the platform, lots of illustrations, stories. He loved to tell stories while he was preaching and so forth. So we have God's truth coming through personality with William and Catherine, no doubt. But for both of them, preaching was the essence of revivalism. It was essential to revivalism. Yeah. Now, there were some other things that were important for William and Catherine besides preaching. And here we'll see how did Catherine and William respond to the Second Great Awakening. Here's a couple of things that we want to take note of. Remember that our core were first called preaching stations. The first thing they were called was preaching stations. And they were pretty remarkable. And you can see here from the Christian mission days, where the gospel is preached. But when we say they were called preaching stations, that tells you how important preaching of the gospel was to William and Catherine and to the Christian missioners. And we've been emphasizing that all through our time together. So that was important. Another thing that was important to William and Catherine, because they were both brought up, yes, we want to mention here that something that they, however, added to in great measure in a way that other people did not in terms of the largeness of the scale was both men and women preaching. Now, of course, Wesley considered this a bit, Finney considered this a bit, but nobody ever added to the scale of women preachers like the Salvation Army did. So your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, Acts 2:17. So they took that literally, that both men and women should prophesy. So preaching stations. But if we could move on then to another thing that was important for them, because they are good Wesleyans, and that was the class meetings. Of course, Catherine was reared a Wesleyan Methodist. William became converted within the Methodist Church, and so was from the age of about 15 or so, was brought up in Methodism. And they both knew the importance of class meetings. Again, the importance of class meetings for strengthening the personal life, helping the believer to conform more and more to the image of Christ, to grow in holiness and so forth. And they were brought up in that tradition. William Booth said this: "We must follow Wesley in class meetings in this, or we will be a rope of sand." Now, here's a little bit of a sad note to our history. We did not continue the strengthening of the class meetings. When I go to officers' councils, I'd really encourage officers to at least consider instituting class meetings in their corps. And even if they have a small corps, they might say, how would I do this? Well, you could take even two or three people from your corps and instituting the class meeting with them, which means meeting once a week with them, helping them to grow in the Lord, helping them to conform more to the image of Christ. I think we would be amazed at the impact that that kind of spiritual living and light would have on the core. But we discontinued class meetings. They eventually just died out, and we haven't recontinued them, but we should. They should be really a part. If we expect revivalism, it's not just the preaching, but it has to be also sustained by class meetings during the week in the core.
Can I just offer an idea here? When you say this, it strikes me that just like an architect, the depth of the foundation depends upon the height of the building that you're able to create, right?
Right.
Similarly, we don't spend time, and this is why equipping is an imperative of the Churchill vision. If we do not spend time equipping salvationists, we're not going to have a great awakening. We need great foundations for great awakenings.
Exactly. And this is so central to equipping salvations, this class meeting. No doubt about that. Yeah.
Amen. Chris Havner agrees.
Great. I just might mention too, I had kind of forgotten about this slide, I have to confess, but sometimes we look back at the early army and we see God working in such miraculous ways. Remember that when they built corps in those days, they often built corps to accommodate 1,200, 1,500, 2,000. In Manchester, England, they built 12 corps in 5 years, and the smallest of the 12 corps sat 300. The largest sat over 2,000. So we often become a little discouraged by that, because we don't see that tremendous impact of the army on a city with these large numbers. But we want to remember two things that are important. Number one, we need to remember that in William and Catherine Booth's day, everybody knew the Bible. There was a biblical literacy. Not everybody read the Bible because there are many people who couldn't read, but they knew the Bible stories by going to church and so forth. So there was a biblical literacy. And there's a great book called A People of One Book. And it talks about the biblical literacy that pervaded Victorian England. And they even have a chapter in that book. All Salvationists should read the book because there's a chapter on Catherine Booth and on William Cook, who was William Booth's trainer for New Connection Methodist ordination. But we need to remember that this was a world of biblical literacy, of understanding the Bible. The second thing we need to remember, and if there's any kind of contribution that my War on Two Fronts book maybe has made, I pray that it has, to an understanding of the theology of the army, is that William and Catherine and everybody around them were postmillennialists. William wrote an article in titled The Millennium or The Ultimate Triumph of Salvation Army Principles. They believed that they were going to win the whole world for Jesus. And they acted as though they were going to win the whole world for Jesus. Wow. So they had this idea of Christian expansion going on. And the army was part of the great missionary movement of the 19th century. But they had those two things going for them. We don't have that in our day. We need to remember that. We don't have, we're not living in a culture of biblical literacy. We're not even living in a culture. We're living in a post-Christian culture. We're living in a culture where there's a decline even in people even interest in the church. Whereas in William and Catherine's day, probably 70% or so of people went to church in their day. Now, in that part of the world, it's about 2% of the people who are going to church. Yeah. So we need to remember that. And we need to remember that post-millennialism, the millennialism of William and Catherine Booth, culturally was sustained in a sense because the world did seem to be getting better and better and more Christian. Well, we now know that that's not the case. World War I and World War II and Vietnam and Korea and unrest in the Middle East and so forth. We do not have this kind of post-millennialism going for us. Yeah. So those two things we need to remember. So, but in spite of the fact that we don't have that, I always say, welcome to the first century, because the world in which we live is very much like the world of first century Christians.
And I think it does, when going back to that first century means, one of the books which was published for junior soldiers to read in the early, late 1890s was called The Red Flowers of Martyrdom. And it was to teach children the fact that we need to sort of recognize that, like the first century Christians, we might have to suffer for what we do. You know, yes. I wonder as well whether or not we need to look to places like the Salvation Army's launching in India for a source of inspiration, because it reflects more of the post-Christian type of environment. You know, and yet, can we still take sort of the principles of what Finney talked about, which translate revivalism into salvationism? And if we live those out today and translate them to our day and age and the conditions in which we're living, these principles, I mean, we still serve the same God. The truth in the God's word is still the same. And even despite incredible obstacles, our commitment is still to the salvation of the world. Yes. It just means that the struggle is going to be a little bit more, and it means that we really need to understand God's word if we're going to communicate this world.
Yes, absolutely. I always say we realize that it's all up to God, but we need to act like it's all up to us.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Commissioner, Dr. Green, I should say, we have some great questions that have been coming through, and one of those is actually from Commissioner Mark Tilsley, and he has this question. He says, would we differentiate between the emphasis on small groups with accountability and class meetings?
Would we differentiate between the emphasis on small groups
with accountability and class meetings? So we got that. It was in two posts. We couldn't post all of them.
Right. Yeah. I think groups, the important word here is accountability. And if we have small groups with accountability, I think that's a pretty good definition of what the class meetings were intended to do and to be.
Yeah.
That is, they weren't just Bible studies. That was part of it, but they weren't just Bible studies. They were Bible studies, but then they were Bible studies to understand how that has affected me. to help me understand how I am conforming more and more to the image of Christ. And the people in the class meeting would bear witness to one another as to what Christ was doing in them and for them, and helping them to grow and develop. So, yeah, I would say small groups with accountability is a class meeting.
And I think the difference, I mean, actually in 1875, there was a period where there were Bible studies that were taking place that was just simply reading things without that accountability, without pressing in to allow that to penetrate who we are and transform us. And William Booth said, if we do that, we're actually inoculating people because the truth isn't actually penetrating who it is that we are. And so I would say that the difference, the class meeting, is one that is driven to allowing the truth to produce a reality within us as the people that are reading that passage.
Right. And so I think of a pastor whom I heard years ago of a large church. One of the things we, of course, the question comes to him, why is your church so large and so vibrant? And for that church, there's the great preaching in the morning, but then they divide up in small groups at lunchtime after the preaching. And they take time to discuss the preaching and how that preaching has affected their lives and how they are growing in God's grace as a result of that preaching and so forth. They literally did a class, you know, it's a class meeting that they were doing after the preaching, so they could take that preaching and immediately apply it to their own individual lives. We want that to be done. I just say quickly that, again, when I'm at officers' councils, if people say to me, well, sometimes officers say to me, we don't even have a Bible study during the week. So all the people are getting is 1 hour one Sunday, another hour another Sunday. We need to rise above that for sure. Yeah. But even if they have a small Bible study, I encourage them, make that Bible study, do the Bible study, but then make it just a little bit more for at least for some of the people in terms of accountability, in terms of ministering to each other, in terms of bearing witness to each other, in terms of conforming to the image of Christ as a group of people. So take what you have, but make it more.
That's truly salvationist. Gideon Wells has a great recommendation. He recommends Dr. Kevin Watson's The Class Meeting, Reclaiming a Forgotten Essential Small Group Experience.
Right.
That was a good resource for me to get people started. Yes. Now, we just have a little bit of time. I think we're almost out of time, but I just want to finish maybe with this last piece, which is the question, how can we prepare for a great awakening? And you have a few sort of key points on that. Maybe we can just take this out and then we'll close out maybe with just the recommendation of that book. But why don't you just go through these last principles and we'll...
Okay. Actively pursuing the Great Awakening. Number one, if we stop now, I'd say we've got a major point here. Concentrate on biblical preaching. We cannot expect a Great Awakening if we don't emphasize biblical preaching. I think we've seen that historically. Number two, to me, would be pray for the will of God to be done. We want that will of God to be done. It's both his timing, but also we can prepare for revival as well. Finney taught us that. Number three, I would say rediscover class meetings, discipleship, and training. Number four, for me, would be make sure that our music reflects our theology and inspires our people. Those two things are very important. I think we should take great care in choosing what songs we're going to sing at our meetings. And are they songs that reflect our theology, but are they songs that give inspiration to our people? And then I think I've got a final one here. And then prepare for revival, both officers and soldiers, men and women, older people and younger people, staff officers and corps officers. You've got the chart here. So prepare for a revival up and down the line. Everybody has to be into this intentionally. If they're not, they need to be brought into this intentionally.
Yeah. Absolutely. Dr. Green, just as we finish, maybe just for next steps, I know that you have a book which you would recommend for people to maybe reach us to read a little bit more on this. What tell us a bit about this book. Besides, by the way, I highly recommend all the books which Dr. Green has written as well. Get your hands on those because it's going to help you to go deeper in this. And we need to know how all of these have been woven together in our own salvationist heritage. But for one additional person, what's this book about?
Very important book. The author is very important. Went to be with the Lord a year ago now, Donald Dayton. Donald Dayton was a scholar of great note. Donald Dayton brought into the conversation of Protestantism the importance of Wesleyanism into that conversation. A lot of scholarship up to that time had really focused on Calvinism and the importance of Calvinism in shaping the church and shaping evangelicalism. Donald Dayton said, we agree with that, but remember that there's this whole Wesleyan movement, which was also important in shaping the church and shaping evangelicalism. And so his scholarship was very important. And he wrote this book. Now, this is a new edition. The original title was Discovering an Evangelical Heritage. Now it's Rediscovering an Evangelical Heritage, a Tradition and Trajectory of Integrating Piety and Justice. And he's got a great chapter in that book on William and Catherine Booth and how they put together preaching of the gospel and social ministry as you know, two parts of the same coin, two sides of the same coin. So this book, I would suggest, if you haven't read this book, this would be top on the list.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. That's so great. Well, friends, we've had a wonderful time here, spending a little bit of time rediscovering the story of the Great Awakening. We are just so blessed to have been able to have Dr. Green take some time out of your busy schedule to come and share this wise insight. I can see why you're a member of the Order of the Founder, because you truly embodied the values and the vision of Catherine and William Booth. And I pray that today that, that the truth which you've been sharing within us is laying a foundation for that very vision. Again, the territorial vision of us being an army that's united in purpose and actively pursuing God's next great awakening. What better time or what better area to focus on now more than ever before? Let's focus on what really matters. Let's rediscover those class meetings. Let's pursue an integration of the head, the heart, and the hand. Let's integrate our revival and our reform. Let's actively pursue next God's next great awakening.
Yes, God.
Dr. Green, would you have a word of prayer with us as we close?
Our Father, we give you thanks for raising up the Salvation Army, not as a group unto ourselves, but part of the great story, part of the great narrative, beginning with Abraham and the covenant, moving through the Old Testament, moving through the scriptures with the coming of Christ, moving through the history of the church. We are delighted that you have so chosen us to be a part of that great story and that great narrative. We pray that we might look at our own story and understand where we need to go for a great awakening within the army around the world, and that we would aid and assist each other, that we would commit ourselves to what it takes for a great awakening, to preaching and proclamation and class meetings and taking care of the poor, that we would commit ourselves to these aspects of what it takes to have a great awakening. We thank you for each person who is here with this live stream or people who will see this. And we pray that this will be helpful and a blessing to their lives. We give you thanks for all good things which come from you. And we pray these things in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Again, thank you so much. Just one last reminder to everyone, make sure to continue to engage on the USA East Salvationist Facebook group. Continue to follow SA Connects for further information. And then again, May the 22nd, we're going to be having our concert of prayer from 7 to 8 p.m. Please, we encourage you to be part of it. Invite your friends, invite your peers. This vision can't be taught. It has to be caught. And as we gather together, as we catch this vision, then we're going to teach in the truth of what God's word is saying. And we can only do that by coming together and having times like this. We're going to have further lunch and learns coming up as well in the following weeks and months. But just continue to pray for this Eastern territory. We know that the enemy would love more than anything to create discord and to separate us from one another. But like the disciples, we need to find our upper room and come together with one accord. So thank you, friends, and we'll look forward to see you all soon. Again, one more time, just thank you to Dr. Roger Green for this wonderful time of teaching. We've learned a lot, and we are grateful to you. You're a blessing to us.
Thank you, Stephen.